الحمد لله رب العالمين، والصلاة والسلام على أشرف الأنبياء والمرسلين نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم تسليما كثيرا، أما بعد. My brothers and my sisters, what I have chosen to go through in these sittings in the month of Ramadan is how to soften up the heart and that which treats it. Because my brothers and my sisters, if we really, really think about it, it could be that we are being deprived this Ramadan from the sweetness of this Quran simply because our hearts have been tainted. Simply because our hearts have been tainted. And what I have chosen to go through is that which treats one's heart through the speeches of Shaykh al-Islam ibn Taymiyyah rahimahullah ta'ala, Ibn al-Qayyim, Ibn al-Jawzi, and also Ibn Rajab, that which I have selected from the speeches in that which I noted down and documented throughout the years. My brothers and my sisters, why is it that we give concern to softening up the heart? Why do the scholars give so much time in speaking about this issue? Why is it they give so much time in authoring books so that one can rectify and also soften up his heart? What is the reason behind this? لِمَاذَا نَهْتَمُّ بِتَطْهِيرِ الْقَلْبِ Why is it that we give so much concern in rectifying and also purifying the heart? Shaykh al-Islam ibn Taymiyyah rahimahullah ta'ala, he says, فَإِنَّ الْقَلْبَ إِذَا كَانَ رَقِيقًا لَيِّنًا كَانَ قَبُولُهُ لِلْعِلْمِ سَهْلًا يَسِيرًا If one's heart is soft and tender, you will find that the ilm that enters into his heart will become very, very easy. وَرَسَخَ الْعِلْمُ فِيهِ وَثَبَتَ وَأَثَّرَ You will find that the ilm will settle in this individual's heart. It will affect it. It will have an influence over it. But then he goes on to say, وَإِنْ كَانَ قَلْبُهُ غَلِيظًا قَاسِيًا كَانَ قَبُولُهُ لِلْعِلْمِ صَعْبًا عَسِيرًا But if his heart is hard and it's also rigid, you will find that the ilm will not be able to enter into his heart, or he will find much difficulty entering into that heart. Because my brothers and my sisters, this ilm is that which brings us life. This ilm is that which is going to get us into al-Jannah. This ilm, my brothers and my sisters, is that which is going to remove the ignorance that we have. It is the light that we are all looking for. It is the direction that we all need in our lives. Ibn al-Jawzi rahimahullah ta'ala, he mentioned, رأيت الاشتغال بالفقه وسماع الحديث لا يكاد يكفي في صلاح القلب إلا أن يمزج بالرقائق والنظر في سير السلف الصالحين. He says, I have noticed that studying fiqh and listening to ahadith is just not enough in order to rectify the heart. That which is required and needed is that when an individual now studies, he pursues that knowledge, there is that fair share of studying the lives of the righteous predecessors. And also, my brothers and my sisters, one should take out time in order to study that which is going to soften up his heart. Ibn Rajab al-Hanbali rahimahullah ta'ala, he mentioned, لَنْ يَخْلُوَ سَمَاعُ أَخْبَارِ الصَّالِحِينَ مِنْ تَحْصِيلِ رِقَّةٍ لِلْقُلُوبِ وَإِزَالَةٍ لِلْقَسْوَةِ He mentions that listening to the lives of the righteous people before us, you will find that this will cause one's heart now to become soft, and it will also remove the rigidness, it will remove the hardness in one's heart. Also, Ibn Rajab al-Hanbali rahimahullah ta'ala, he says, al-ishtighalu bi tathhir al-qulub afdalu min al-istikthar min as-sawm was-salah ma'a ghish al-qulub. One busying himself, taking out time in purifying the heart, it is better than being someone who has a lot of sawm and a lot of salawat that are supererogatory, that are recommended, while the heart, my brothers and my sisters, is diseased. It is sick. So my brothers and my sisters, it could be that we are not attaining the maximum of this Ramadan. We are not able to spend hours of our time in being able to recite the book of Allah Ta'ala simply because, my brothers and my sisters, our hearts have become tainted. Our hearts have become diseased. Yesterday I was telling my little brother, my little sister, that if you really want to put yourself to the test, to see if your heart is sick or not, then put it to the test by sitting with the Quran. We can sit in front of the TV, watch Netflix. We can sit in front of the TV, play GTA. We can play all of these games. We can watch 90-minute football matches. The moment somebody goes past the TV, we throw something at him or we call out, get off or get away, move away. Why? Because we're so into that which we are watching. We are so into that which we are concentrating on. But my brothers and my sisters, is that the same reaction that we have when someone tries to busy us from the Quran? When we sit with the Quran, my brothers and my sisters, how long can we actually sit there and recite the speech of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? This is a way, my brothers and my sisters, to really see if there is something wrong with our hearts. Uthman ibn Affan radiallahu ta'ala anhu, he said, لو طهرت قلوبنا لما شبعنا من كلام ربنا. Had our hearts been pure, we would not have become bored of reciting the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Ibn al-Qayyim rahimahullah ta'ala, he says, فَالْقَلْبُ الطَّاهِرُ لِكَمَالِ حَيَاتِهِ وَنُورِهِ وَتَخَلُّصِهِ مِنَ الْأَدْرَانِ وَالْخَبَائِثِ لَا يَشْبَعُ مِنَ الْقُرْآنِ. If the heart now becomes enlightened, my brothers and my sisters, with complete life, وَتَخَلُّصِهِ مِنَ الْأَدْرَانِ وَالْخَبَائِثِ, and you find that the heart is no longer tainted, it doesn't have any impurities stuck onto it, لا يشبع من القرآن, it will not become bored of the Quran. ولذا, and this is why my brothers and my sisters, Ibn al-Qayyim rahimahullah ta'ala, he mentions in his Nuniyah, حب الكتاب وحب ألحان الغناء في قلب عبد ليس يجتمعان. The love of music and the love of the Quran are two things that just can't come together in one's heart. This is a ma'siyah, right? It is a sin. It's something that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala strongly despises. Listening to music and something that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala really loves for us to engage in is the recitation of the Quran. These are two things that just can't come together in one's heart. So if a person is continuously sinning, you will find that this will place a barrier in between him and also being able to engage with the Quran. Ibn Uthaymeen rahimahullah ta'ala, my brothers and my sisters, he says, مَنْ طَهَّرَ قَلْبَهُ مِنَ الْمَعَاصِي كَانَ أَفْهَمَ لِلْقُرْآنِ. Whoever purifies his heart from al-ma'asi, from sinning, from doing that which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala really despises, كَانَ أَفْهَمَ لِلْقُرْآنِ, this person will have a better understanding. He will have a better understanding of the Quran. وَمَنْ تَنَجَّسَ قَلْبُهُ بِالْمَعَاصِي كَانَ أَبْعَدَ فَهْمًا عَنِ الْقُرْآنِ. And whoever's heart now becomes impure, it has najis on it, and he has these impurities of sins onto his heart, you find that he will be further away. He will be more distant with regards to being able to understand the Quran. Can you see, my brothers and my sisters, this is a common question that people tend to ask all the time. How can I start seeking knowledge? How can I have a relationship with the Quran? How can I purify my heart? My brothers and my sisters, this is maybe the answer that we have been looking for all of these years. Ramadan comes by every single year. We try to have that relationship, but it just doesn't seem to be happening. A place to start, my brothers and my sisters, is the hearts that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has gifted to us, because this is what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala looks at when he looks onto his creation. The Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, إِنَّ اللَّهَ لَا يَنْظُرُ إِلَى صُوَرِكُمْ وَلَا إِلَى أَجْسَادِكُمْ وَلَكِنْ يَنْظُرُ إِلَى قُلُوبِكُمْ وَإِلَى أَعْمَالِكُمْ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala doesn't look at your outer appearance. He doesn't look at our bodies. He does not look at how big or how small or how thin or how tall we are. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala doesn't look at any of these things. What color skin you are, how dark, how light, how red, how yellow. These are things that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does not give any consideration to. But that which he looks at, my brothers and my sisters, is the hearts. And he also looks at the bodies. If you think about it, my brothers and my sisters, and you take a close look at the creation, and even more so ourselves, how much of our time do we give to the outer appearance? A brother who works out, my brothers and my sisters, how many hours does he give to the gym? You find that he spends maybe 8-9 hours a day working out, pushing out these muscles that he really, really wants to push out, right? He spends all of this time, my brothers and my sisters. He spends all of this time. A sister, she might stand in front of the mirror a couple of hours just so she can purify and also what? Beautify her outer appearance. I remember, subhanAllah, many years ago when I was working, as I walked into the workplace, there was a bunch of guys who were mocking and ridiculing a particular lady. Why were they ridiculing her? Simply because she told them that she wakes up 3 hours before her shift in order to put the makeup on, in order to beautify her outer appearance. And they found this very, very funny. Hence why they were ridiculing. They were making fun of her. Can you see, my brothers and my sisters, how many hours a person spends perfecting the outer appearance, even though Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will not look at that. If only we gave a fraction to that in rectifying our hearts, we might be in a better place in this dunya, and it will be a big benefit to us in the hereafter. So my brothers and my sisters, there's 10 ways or 10 points that I would like to mention from the speeches of Ibn Taymiyyah, Ibn al-Qayyim, Ibn Rajab, Ibn al-Jawzi that I have collected, which treats and also rectifies and purifies the heart. And in this sit, inshallah ta'ala, I will mention one thing, and in the upcoming sittings, I will try to mention the remaining that I have written down. The first thing, my brothers and my sisters, that rectifies the heart generally is doing what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala loves for you to do. Doing the righteous actions and putting Him before everything else. Ibn Taymiyyah rahimahullah ta'ala, he says, وَلَيْسَ لِلْقُلُوبِ سُرُورٌ وَلَا لَذَّةٌ تَامَّةٌ إِلَّا فِي مَحَبَّةِ اللَّهِ وَالتَّقَرُّبِ إِلَيْهِ بِمَا يُحِبُّهُ. He says that the heart will not be able to find happiness, and it will also not be able to taste complete sweetness, إِلَّا فِي مَحَبَّةِ اللَّهِ, except if this heart becomes a heart that loves Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, وَالتَّقَرُّبِ إِلَيْهِ بِمَا يُحِبُّهُ, and also one draws close to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in that which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala loves. وَلَا تُمْكِنُ مَحَبَّتُهُ إِلَّا بِالْإِعْرَاضِ عَنْ كُلِّ مَحْبُوبٍ سِوَاهُ. And you will find that the heart will not be able to love Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala greatly except if it turns away from everything besides Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَهَذَا حَقِيقَةُ لَا إِلَهِ لَلَّهِ وَهِيَ مِلَّةُ إِبْرَاهِيمَ وَهِيَ مِلَّةُ إِبْرَاهِيمَ الْخَلِيلِ. This is the reality of La ilaha illallah. So just to recap, he says, you will not be able to love Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala truly except if you turn away from everything besides Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Does that mean, my brothers and my sisters, I can't love my mom, I can't love my wife, I can't love my husband, I can't love my father? Is that what Ibn al-Qayyim rahimahullah ta'ala, Ibn Taymiyyah is referring to? The answer is no, my brothers and my sisters. What he's referring to is, as he also mentions in Majmu' al-Fatawa, وَعْلَمْ أَنَّ كُلَّ مَنْ أَحَبَّ شَيْئًا لِغَيْرِ اللَّهِ فَلَا بُدَّ أَنْ يَضُرَّهُ مَحْبُوبُهُ. Anyone who loves besides Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala something, then it is a must that he will be harmed and he will be hurt by that which he loves besides Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The moment, my brothers and my sisters, you start giving precedence to other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, okay, and you put everything before Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then this is, my brothers and my sisters, when you start missing out on the love that we are all looking for, the sweetness that we really, really want to taste, and we begin to become hurt by that which we have given precedence to over Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And a couple of examples to that, my brothers and my sisters, The call of the prayer is being called out. The adhan is going off. Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar. If I was to ask you, what does Allahu Akbar mean? You would say to me that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the greatest. Even though we say this with our tongues, my brothers and my sisters, do we actually really live by it? Do we really act upon this with our outer limbs? Even though it's so easy to say it with our tongues. When the call of prayer is being called out, my brothers and my sisters, but we decide to continue in watching that football game or that Netflix movie or that game that we play, are we really, my brothers and my sisters, living by Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar? Are we really putting Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala first? If somebody was to insult Allah Azza wa Jal, you would become upset. But indirectly, my brothers and my sisters, bilisan al-hal, what are we doing? We are saying that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is not the greatest. We are indirectly saying that which we are watching is more greater than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, simply because you have given precedence to that thing over Allah Azza wa Jal. Whether it's your job, whether it is your wife, whether it is anything else that has now busied you from what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants you to do. Imam Shafi'i rahimahullah ta'ala, he said, فَإِذَا أَرَدْتَ أَن تَعْرِفَ مَقَامَكَ فَانْظُرْ فِيمَا أَقَامَكَ. If you really want to know your position عند الله subhanahu wa ta'ala, with Allah Azza wa Jal, then see what really causes you to stand up to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala when the command comes. وَهَذَا مِصْدَاقُ قَوْلِ النَّبِيِّ صَلَى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمُ. And this is, my brothers and my sisters, what the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has told us, that which is in conjunction with what Ibn Taymiyyah rahimahullah ta'ala mentioned. وَعَلَمْ أَنَّ كُلَّ مَنْ أَحَبَّ شَيْئًا لِغَيْرِ اللَّهِ فَلَا بُدَّ أَنْ يَضُرَّهُ مَحْبُوبُهُ. No, have knowledge of that if an individual now loves besides Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala more than Allah Azza wa Jal, فَلَا بُدَّ أَنْ يَضُرُّهُ مَحْبُوبُهُ. That which he has loved, it is a must that he will become hurt by it. You're trying to please the creation before Allah Azza wa Jal, right? You're giving the creation precedence over Allah Azza wa Jal. What did the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam say, my brothers and my sisters? من التمس رضا الناس بسخط الله سخط الله عنه وأسخط عنه الناس. Whoever tries to seek the pleasure of the creation, and this is besides Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, right? And through that he enrages Allah Azza wa Jal. What Allah Azza wa Jal will do to him, my brothers and my sisters, is Allah will become upset with him, Allah will become angry with him, and he will make the creation angry with you as well. You worked so hard, you put that individual or that sister or your wife or your parents or whatever it might be, your job, before Allah Azza wa Jal. You tried to please them and you threw Allah Azza wa Jal behind you. It's only a matter of time where everything, my brothers and my sisters, will start going downhill. All of these things that you have now started loving more than Allah Azza wa Jal, it's only a matter of time before they actually end up hurting you. So my brothers and my sisters, put Allah Azza wa Jal first. And don't let the shaitan, my brothers and my sisters, really get to you by fearing you or causing you now to become scared of being afflicted by poverty, or that you're going to go through problems. If you wasn't going to do this particular thing, but rather you find, my brothers and my sisters, and give this a go. You don't leave something for the sake of Allah Azza wa Jal, except Allah Azza will give you that which is far better and far greater. So my brothers and my sisters, the first point that we took is that a person cannot taste the sweetness in his heart until he does what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala told him to do. Put Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala first and then see how you feel. Subhanaka Allahumma bihamdik. Ashhadu an la ilaha illa ant. Astaghfiruka wa atubu ilayk. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.